happens like Glasgow and Manchester, and not quite enough of Liverpool. Sorry, I didn't say that. So the Blitz actually is geographically spread across the country a fair amount in industrial urban areas. 43,000 civilians die during the process, and very significantly for what happens after the war, 1 million houses are destroyed. So the answer to this is to build air shelters. Okay, in London, this is very easily taken care of because the underground system, the London Tube, provided a point of communal access to shelters. Okay, there were actually two disasters in tube shelters during the Second World War, but effectively the tube system provided a good type of communal shelter for Londoners. Middle class families, however, built their own shelters. The tube would either didn't get reach into their areas, or they didn't want to be sheltering with the great unwashed. And so they built their own so-called Anderson shelters, as you can see in this bottom image, is what they look. You can build these in the back of your garden. Doesn't look to me like it's going to survive a bomb falling on top of it. But many people built these things, and you can see inside here the very cozy and alluring interior, and the sort of boy's own adventure at the top. The point is that the middle classes had access to a different type of shelter to many of the working class people. Evacuation is another good example of this phenomenon, because it demonstrates the way in which Britons thought of themselves as part of a new community. Evacuation was designed to get children out of urban areas so that when the bombs came, they wouldn't be the casualties. You would save the next generation. Okay? And quite remarkably, the nation is now imagined as one big family, with the children as sort of transferable units. It didn't matter if they were my kids or your kids. We could send them, I could send them over to you, and you would look after them for the war, and we were all in it together as one big national family. If anyone actually does want to take my kids, they are more than welcome to do so for the duration of whatever war you want to imagine. So over 3.5 million kids are evacuated in this way, arriving in train stations like this with instructions, waving goodbye to their parents. Most of those come in the immediate period of the Blitz from September 1939. There's a second wave of evacuation in 1944, which is when the Germans start using doodle bugs. Does anyone know what a doodle bug is? Gavin, tell them what a doodle bug is. Right. Yeah, it was. It was that's a great way of describing it. It was sort of like drone bombing, except for what they did was that they turned the drone off. Okay, so you'd have this missile coming over, you could hear the engine, and then you were in trouble. If you heard the engine, that was fine. You wanted to hear the engine. When the engine stopped, you just heard this deathly whistle of this thing like hurtling towards the ground, and then you were in trouble because you never knew where it was going to land. And so another 1 million kids were evacuated during that period. But this idea of the happy national family was quickly undone, which is to say that there are a whole series of scandals that surrounded the experience of evacuation. On the plus side, many middle-class families who lived in the countryside were discovered, the acute poverty of many working class children. Children turning up and they didn't have shoes, or they didn't have the proper clothes, or they were deeply malnourished, or that, you know, they were suffering from bronchitis or lice or whatever. And many people did a fantastic job at recuperating these kids. Some others, of course, treated them as effectively prisoners in their own house. They got that kid the ration share for that kid. So many stories about kids being locked up in their bedrooms and given, you know, a fraction of their own rations, and the rest of the family using the rations. Others, stories of sexual abuse or of violent abuse have begun to emerge from the experience of evacuation. And indeed, the psychological trauma of separation from parents at a young age was something that was intensely studied during the Second World War and becomes important to the types of welfare institutions created after the Second World War, as we'll see next week. There was also a type of informal middle class evacuation. Just as the middle class could build their own Anderson shelters, so they didn't have to send their kids out on the official evacuation schemes. So my mother, for instance, whose parents lived in South London that was heavily bombed, my mother was sent to live in Surrey with the family of the boss of her father. Who worked in London. My father, who lived in North London, was sent down to a distant family friend who lived in Devon. So again, a differential experience of people, fractured in terms of class. There's also a fracturing in terms of race. Now, you'll remember that the First World War had been the occasion for a new set of claims by colonial subjects for national independence. And I talked to you about the spread of revolts across the empire in 1919, when it was clear that the extra political rights that colonial subjects were demanding had been effectively denied to them. So along comes the Second World War, and the Colonial Office is given the very difficult job of trying to remobilize colonial soldiers again. Britain wasn't going to be able to fight this war by itself. It needed the support of the Empire, and somehow they had to get colonial soldiers engaged. There are basically two ways in which they do this. The first is that they lift the colour bar in the military, okay, and so that they allow troops from different places to serve alongside each other, okay, and of different colours. Now, they continue to have African regiments, they continue to have Malayan regiments, regiments from Hong Kong, but they also had regiments where people fought alongside. It was, however, the case that the African regiments always had English officers, because Africans weren't considered appropriate officer material. The second thing that they did was to place a new rhetorical emphasis on partnership. Okay, on colonial partnership. Okay, this was the first steps towards an idea that the empire was going to go, and you were going to have this new thing called the Commonwealth that becomes very important after the Second World War. So now there's not a sense of a colonial hierarchy with Britain at the top, but are now a family of nations, a partnership, where everybody would come to defend and fight against fascism. And many people actually seriously buy this. Not just in terms of the numbers of colonial troops that are mobilized, but also in the colonial donations to war charities. So, for instance, Nigerians sent £250,000 to a whole series of war charities in Britain, and the West African colonies gave up as much as £1.5 million in charitable donations. So there's a real, you know, investment in this common war effort still. However, it's the Americans, dun dun dun, who mess up this picture of perfect imperial and racial harmony. Because when we, because I'm obviously an American too, finally arrive in the war, late, they insist in maintaining the color bar in the American military. Okay? And Churchill has to accept this. He has to accept that the American military maintains its color bar, because otherwise the American military weren't going to allow their troops to go to Britain. And this causes really profound political difficulties for the Colonial Office, who on the one hand trying to say, oh, we don't have any color bar in the British military, no, this is a completely different world, and on the other hand saying, well, yeah, actually, we're all across Britain in these American military bases, African Americans are treated in a separate category to everybody else. So in the area that I used to live in, where I grew up, which was in East Anglia, there are a whole series of American military bases, and in my hometown of Ipswich, there were bars that had, you know, like drinking bars that were just for African Americans, that were separated out just for the African American troops. Indeed, it's in that area that the most amount of mixed race relationships happened in Britain during the war. And as you know, and this isn't about the maintenance of the color bar, there are a whole series of war brides who come back to live with their American partners, white and black, after the war. Something like 70,000 British women migrate to the US to live with American servicemen after the war. And a good deal more than that had a lot of fun with them when they were in Britain and then were happy to wave goodbye. And I'm not going to tell you about my grandmother, who absolutely refused to acknowledge anything until her dying days. But she used to enjoy a game of darts, I can tell you that much, with the American soldiers. Okay, any questions on that before I move to the final bit of the lectures about how this all translates into a positive agenda for peace? Gavin. It was policed by the American military police. So you had American military bases that maintained the color bar, and then when the American troops went out, they went out in different times, policed by the military police, and bars were cleared so that African Americans would have their own, you know, special clubs and bars. No, it was quite a thing. English people were still allowed to go into them. It was just white Americans who were not allowed to go in. So there was, and that's how you had dances where you know, this was the first time for many English women that they'd seen a person of color.